Will this new method finally lead me to the perfect macarons that I have been hoping for so long? Or will it lead me to yet another disaster that's waiting to happen? Stick around to find out for yourself! Hi! My name is Tiffany and welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be making some cranberry eggnog macarons. Now, how did these guys turn out? Well, you're going to have to wait till the end of the video to find out. Though, I'm already guessing that you guys were already spoiled by the thumbnail, and so you already have an idea on how these macarons actually turn out. But please, just let me pretend it's still a surprise to you guys, okay? Pretty please! So if the idea of having surprise macarons sounds enticing to you, or you just simply enjoy cranberries, eggnog, and or macarons in general, then please give this video a like. And if you are new here and you're enjoying the content that you are seeing here so far, then please hit that subscribe button and ring that notification bell to be notified whenever I make a new baking tutorial or short. I make new baking content every week, and my content is suitable for beginners and experienced bakers alike. So if that sounds like you, and you don't mind a little bit of self-deprecating humor sprinkled here and there from time to time, then why don't you stick around for a little bit and make yourselves comfortable. And who knows, you might actually learn something from me too while you're at it. So quite a few people have suggested to me that I should try making macarons using the French method, as the Italian method can be a little bit too complicated if you don't know what you are doing, and so this is how this recipe was born. These macarons features a French macaron shell that is filled with some cranberry sauce and some eggnog cream cheese buttercream for a combination that surprisingly goes well together, to be honest. Like, I already tried a few of these and I'm still in shock with how delicious these macarons are, and yet here we are! I also added in some sugared rosemary and cranberry to the mix to give these macarons a little extra kick to them, but you can totally leave those out if you prefer. I only did them because I thought it would have made the macarons a little bit more prettier, or at least that's what I thought at first. Now, if you prefer to make your macarons using the Italian method, I've included some instructions on how to go about that on my website. Or if you're more of a visual learner, then please watch my pumpkin spice macaron video to see how I made my macarons using the Italian method. Though mine didn't turn out so well, I'm pretty sure you'll do an even better job at making them. So will these macarons turn out even better than the last time? Or will they be just as disastrous despite using a different method? Well, let's go get started on them, shall we? And let's go find out for ourselves.
But before we get started on the macarons, we have to do some prep work first. I know, fun, right? Okay, you can stop rolling your eyes now and get started on the cranberry sauce, will ya? To a medium-sized bowl, add in 1 cup or 200 grams of granulated sugar and the zest of 2 oranges, and using your fingers, rub the sugar into the zest until the sugar has been fully infused with the orange. Pour the infused sugar into a large pot and then add in 6 tablespoons or 90 milliliters of fresh orange juice and 2 tablespoons or 30 milliliters of water and mix together until combined. Then add in 12 ounces or about 1 whole pack of fresh cranberries to the pot and just toss together. Cook the cranberries on medium heat for about 5 to 7 minutes or until the cranberries start to pop and the sauce starts to thicken. You'll know that the sauce is ready to go when you drag your spoon across the bottom of the pot and it takes about 2 seconds for it to come back together. Then pour the sauce into a blender and give it a quick puree until smooth. So maybe like 3 to 5 pulses of the blender? Pour the pureed cranberry sauce into a large heat-safe container and cover with some plastic wrap directly on top of the sauce. Chill this sauce in the fridge for at least 2 hours or until it has thickened to a jammy consistency. Next, we're going to sugar some cranberries and rosemary for the macarons, and it's also to help add a bit of pizzazz to them as well. So, to a large pot, add in 1/2 cup or 100 grams of granulated sugar and the zest of 1 orange and just toss together until fully infused. Then add in 1/4 cup or 60 milliliters each of fresh orange juice and your water and just mix together to combine. Cook the sugar syrup on medium heat without stirring it until it reaches a temperature of 230 degrees Fahrenheit or 110 degrees Celsius before removing from the heat and adding in 12 ounces or 340 grams of your fresh cranberries and just toss them together until the cranberries are fully coated in the syrup. Allow the cranberries to cool to room temperature before tossing in some additional sugar. To another medium-sized bowl, add in 1 cup or 200 grams of granulated sugar, and once the cranberries have cooled, toss them in the sugar in small batches at a time. Place the sugared cranberries on a large baking tray and continue this process until all of your cranberries have been candied. Then set the sugared cranberries aside for now and do the same thing with the rosemary. To a small saucepan, add in 3/4 cups or 150 grams of granulated sugar and 3/4 cups or 180 milliliters of water and mix together until the sugar has dissolved. Place the saucepan over medium heat and once again cook the sugar syrup to 230 degrees Fahrenheit or 110 degrees Celsius before adding in your rosemary. Use about 1 to 2 bunches of fresh rosemary and coat it in the sugar syrup. Allow the rosemary to cool before tossing with some more sugar. To yet another medium-sized bowl, or the same bowl as the last time if it's not too dirty, add in 3/4 cups or 150 grams of granulated sugar and toss the rosemary with the sugar until the rosemary has been thoroughly coated. Repeat with the rest and then set them aside for now. And now we can finally get started on the macarons! Well, sort of. First, we have to age our egg whites before we can even whip them up. So, using 2 separate bowls, or 3 if you are really bad with separating them, carefully separate 4 large eggs and add the egg whites to one bowl and the yolks to the other bowl while making sure not to get any egg yolks in your whites or you have to start all over again and nobody wants that. Once the eggs have been separated, cover the egg whites with some plastic wrap or pour into a sealable container and leave them to age at room temperature for 24 hours before proceeding with the recipe. Next, we are going to quickly draw some circles onto a parchment paper lined baking tray. Using a pencil, draw a few circles using a 2-inch wide circle and make sure to leave about 1.5 inches of space in between the circles so that the macarons don't touch each other and flip the paper over once you are done. You can also skip this step if you have a silicone mat with a macaron template on it and, in fact, your macarons will bake up even better if you use a silicone mat. I'm only doing this because I currently don't own one, and this is also pretty helpful for those of us who also don't own a macaron mat. But it's a really good investment that you should really consider getting for the best results. Then we are also going to toast our almond flour. Again, completely optional, but I'm just doing this to give the macarons some extra flavor to them. To a large baking tray, add in 150 grams of almond flour and spread it evenly on the tray. Toast in a 350 degree Fahrenheit oven or 177 degrees Celsius for 7 to 10 minutes or until the flour has a toasty golden brown color, like so. Allow the almond flour to cool completely before sifting it. While that's cooling, sift in 150 grams of icing sugar into another bowl. And though I usually sift this for 3 times before doing the almond flour to make it slightly more fine, you can just sift this once and it should still be okay since we're going to be sifting them together later on. And once the almond flour has cooled, sift it into a large bowl to help it become smooth again. And do you see these large bits that are left back from sifting them? Discard them, as you really don't want any lumps in your macarons and you want it to be as smooth as possible. Add the sifted almond flour to the bowl of icing sugar and give them a quick toss together before sifting them into a large bowl. And yes, I'm using a completely different sifter that's much smaller than the last one, but it got ruined from the almond flour, so this might take a while here. Repeat the process of sifting your almond flour and icing sugar for 3 times and making sure to discard any large bits that may be left behind after sifting before dividing the dry ingredients evenly into 2 bowls. Since we are going to be making 2 different colors for the macarons, I thought it would be much easier to do it this way. But if you prefer to divide the colors after making the macaronage, you can do it that way if you prefer. And if you're feeling more confident in your macaron skills, then add in 1/2 teaspoon of vanilla extract and 1/4 teaspoon of almond extract to each of the bowls. Though you should probably do that part once you've added in the first batch of the egg whites so that there's no chance of any lumps forming. So basically for this part, do as I say and not as I do. Learn from our mistake, folks. For the egg whites, you're going to be adding in 100 grams of caster sugar or granulated sugar if you can't find any. Though caster sugar works best here, especially when you're working with French macarons. And if there's any clumps in the sugar, just quickly break it apart using your hands until the sugar is nice and smooth again. Add in the aged egg whites to a large bowl and add in 1/4 teaspoon of cream of tartar and gently whisk it together using a fork. Remember when I told you guys about acids in egg whites and how it makes the meringue even stronger and has more elasticity in them thanks to the decreased moisture found in aged egg whites? This is another reason why cream of tartar is so important here in this step. Consider this as extra security and insurance. Whip the egg whites on low speed using a hand or stand mixer, and once the egg whites begin to become frothy and leave trails behind from the whisk, increase the speed to medium and gradually add in your sugar in 3 installments. Mix the egg whites for about 10 seconds before adding in the next installment. Once all the sugar has been added in, increase the speed to high and continue to whip your egg whites until you get stiff peaks. You'll know when you've reached this stage when the meringue points straight up when you dip your whisk in and the egg whites don't fall on your head when you tip it upside down. Divide the egg whites evenly into 2 and add them to each of the almond flour bowls in 2 installments. And this is actually where you should add in your extracts, not when I did mine. That's why I got some lumps in mine after all. Add in your red gel food coloring to one of the bowls and leave the other one plain. Gently fold in the egg whites into the dry ingredients while making sure to knock out some of the air on the sides of the bowl so that you don't get hollows. Once the egg whites have been incorporated and the almond flour is smooth, add in the second batch of egg whites and continue to gently fold your egg whites while spreading it on the sides of the bowl until the mixture reaches a lava consistency. You'll know that it's ready when the mixture flows slowly from your spatula and you can do figure eights with it, and it takes about 10 to 15 seconds for the mixture to smooth out. Any less than this and your mixture is more than likely overmixed. Try to mix more carefully next time should this happen, okay? Don't worry, this is still my biggest issue here too. Then add the plain colored batter to the red batter, or the other way around if you prefer, and gently swirl together 1 to 2 times. Don't overdo it or you'll lose the swirls and it will end up being the solid color instead of a cool effect. Again, learn from our mistake here. Pour the batter into a large piping bag that's fitted with a Wilton 1/8 tip or similar size round tip, and carefully pipe the batter onto the baking tray inside the stencils that we've just made, or on your silicone mat if you are using that instead. Then bang your pan on top of the counter or on a tablecloth lined counter if you live with people who doesn't want any damage to their precious countertops. This will help get rid of any air bubbles that may be trapped in your macaron shells, and this will also cause cracking and hollows should any remain in the macarons. Then, using a toothpick or a sharp paring knife, pop any fine air bubbles that you may find, and then dust the tops of the shells with some silver luster dust. Allow the shells to dry at room temperature for about 30 to 60 minutes, or until a skin has formed on top of the shells and is dry to the touch. Preheat your oven to 290 degrees Fahrenheit or 143 degrees Celsius. Once the skin has formed on the shells, bake them in the oven for 15 to 20 minutes or until the feet have formed and the bottom of the shells is no longer sticking to the pan. And make sure to keep a close eye on them so that it doesn't become too browned. In the meantime, let's quickly make the eggnog buttercream. Once again, I'm asking you to brown 1/4 cup or 60 grams of unsalted butter and melt in and brown in your butter over medium heat in a small saucepan until the milk solids have a nice golden brown color to them. I really need to write a tutorial on this since you practically see browned butter of some sort in every episode. So if you agree with me here, please let me know what you think of that idea in the comments. Pour the browned butter into a heat-safe bowl and cover and chill it in the fridge until the butter has set, so about an hour or so. Then bring the butter back to room temperature before placing it in a medium-sized bowl along with 6 ounces or 170 grams of full-fat cream cheese and, using a spatula or a hand mixer if it's not too late at night, cream the butter and cream cheese together until it's nice and smooth, about 3 minutes. Sift in 4.5 cups or 562 grams of icing sugar over the cream cheese mixture in 2 installments and continue to cream together on medium speed or by hand until the mixture is light and fluffy and smooth. Add in 2 tablespoons or 30 milliliters of eggnog, 2 teaspoons of vanilla extract or vanilla bean paste, 1 teaspoon of rum extract, 1/2 teaspoon of salt, and 1 teaspoon of nutmeg and mix everything together until fully combined. Pour the buttercream into a large piping bag fitted with a small star tip such as a Wilton 21 and set aside for now. Okay, so the macarons have finished baking now and while these don't look exactly the best here as I did leave some lumps in mine from adding in the extracts too early, hence the cracked shells, at least these guys have feet on them this time around and it looks somewhat roundish, so I guess some progress was made here. Allow the shells to cool completely before removing them from the parchment paper or silicone mat and match each of the shells to another shell of a similar size. Pipe some buttercream on top of half of your macaron shells, making sure to leave some space in the middle for the cranberry sauce to go in. Once again, I failed to find a small enough tip for this, and that is why mine looked the way that they do, but hey, at least it still kind of held the jam in, right? Right? Please say yes. Then add a teaspoon-sized amount of cranberry sauce to the center of the macaron and then carefully sandwich the 2 halves together. Place them in a large container lined with wax paper and cover and chill in the fridge overnight and preferably for 24 hours so that the macaron has a chance to mature properly. Now this last step is completely optional, but I chose to do it anyway because I really wanted to make these macarons even more cute. And so, if you are crazy like I am, add in 1.5 cups or 188 grams of icing sugar, and it really does not matter if you sift it or not. It's just some royal icing we're making here, and I really don't see much difference between sifted and non-sifted anyways when it comes to royal icing. So just try to prove me wrong here. Then add in 1.5 tablespoons of meringue powder and 2 tablespoons plus 1 teaspoon of water and mix them together by hand until the icing is nice and thick, like so. Carefully spread a small amount of icing on the edge of the macaron and add a piece of rosemary on top along with a small sugared cranberry. And then this was exactly the moment that I've realized that I've made the biggest mistake of my life here, and this extra step was truly optional here. The way that I decorated them looks so dumb here, and it's like this would have looked a lot better if I had some really tiny cranberries to go on this. So if I were you, only do this step if you have tiny cranberries on hand and you are artistically gifted, because this just looks really weird and it looks even better in my head, to be honest. But yeah, other than that, your cranberry eggnog macarons are finally completed, and these still look pretty good for what it's worth. Though, I could have done better in terms of making the macarons, at least they're starting to actually look like them, especially with the feet on them, unlike last time. And the shell itself is a bit softer than the Italian shells, but it's still just as pretty here. These remind me so much of the strawberry rhubarb macarons that I had made back in my birthday in terms of appearance and taste, and while these are great on its own, I prefer to enjoy these with some eggnog on the side. I really hope that you enjoy these macarons, you guys.
And there you have it, cranberry eggnog macarons. Though these aren't exactly perfect, it's a step in in the right direction. I mean, at least I got feet on my macarons this time around. And they didn't spread out as much as the last time, so I guess I'm making some real progress here. So I will take it as a sign to continue making macarons using the French method, as that seems to be the easiest here, at least until I get the hang of things. And then I can finally go back to making macarons using the Italian method, since Italian macarons will always be my favorite kind of macarons. And it's also one of my favorites too. Down the hatch! Definitely one of my favorites here. I love the combination of cranberry eggnog. It simply can't be beat. And consider this like the wintry and holiday version of the strawberry rhubarb macarons that I did way back at my birthday. This tastes almost identical, like the tanginess and the creaminess just brings me back to the summertime. And oh my god, this is just unbelievable. You'd have to give this a try. So that is it for today's video. If you enjoyed this recipe and you like what you see here and you're excited to give these cranberry eggnog macarons a try and do an even better job at making them, then please give this video a like and leave a comment down below and tell me what you think of them, especially if you're going to give this recipe a try. Share this video so that others can also try their hand at making their own cranberry eggnog macarons. And if you're not already following me, but you enjoy the baking content that I do on here, then please hit that subscribe button and ring that notification bell to be notified whenever I make a new baking tutorial or shorts. Follow me on Instagram and TikTok. Both usernames are Tips Patisserie, and the full written recipe to today's cranberry eggnog macarons will be on my website, tipspatisserie.wordpress.com. The link to that is in the description box down below. And until next time, you guys, stay safe out there, peace out, and I'll see you guys in my next video. Now, if you don't mind, I'm off to enjoy some more of these macarons, as well as to enjoy some eggnog to go with it. So I'll see you guys next time. Bye!